We should view our spiritual pursuits the way a rich person views money. And I can tell you that the rich, they're always thinking about money. They never stop. Every moment of the day, they're focused on money. Their mind never gets off of it. That's how you become wealthy. So if we want to be spiritually wealthy, our mind has to never get off of it. And my mind never gets off of it. It's always on it, in one way or the other. It's never on money. I never give a thought to money. I never give a thought to anything else, really. It's always on getting free from misery, really, right? Finding our real treasure. So it should be like a career, but even more than that, like a very wealthy person who's always focused on money. This is just the way to be. Be focused on spiritual truth all the time. I'm very tired right now because just the shock of putting up 300 new pictures, or pictures that are really not in circulation in the world, of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Suddenly putting them all in circulation all at once. I mean, one picture for me was an extraordinary thing. If I found one picture that's not in circulation, that was a huge deal. Really, but the 300 at once. But she tricked me into it. Yeah. Which is good. Which is good. But I'm paying a price for that. I feel really tired. It's upset the apple cart. It's got something moving. It's got something going. It's shaken up the world in a certain way. And there's more to come. There is more to come, actually. Yeah, a lot more to come. We're just starting here. The wonderful, wonderful journey home is accelerating for us, as it should, right? So let's not anyone be surprised. We understand the dogfight of the world is, there's various ways to look at it. But I could tell you one thing. The dinosaurs saved the liberals for dessert. And the liberals, I have to tell you this, I mean, I'm not choosing sides, I'm just saying what is going on in the world, okay? I'm very observant, and God helps me say, look at this, look at this, look at this, and I say, wow. Because I used to be a number one liberal, for sure. But God said, wait a minute, you know, that's not really a safe place to be. Let me show you a safer place. So I know what's going on, but I'm just pointing out what is happening. It's kind of like the liberals are saying, oh my God, the dinosaurs are going to eat us all. And they say, oh my gosh, how can we not be eaten alive by them? And they think, oh, let's be nice to them. Okay. So being a liberal is being nice to the dinosaurs, the reptilians. It's being nice to them, hoping they won't get eaten. And the dinosaurs say, oh my gosh, there's some nice people on earth. We hate those religious people who keep having faith in God, that somehow God has more power than we do. And that just boils our scales, you know? But the nice liberals say, oh, come here, you can come. Let's share the planet with you. We can share. Let's all share. We'll be nice. And we don't really have that much faith. You know, you don't have to worry about us. That's not that important to us. And the reptilians say, aren't they nice? Yeah, very nice. And we'll eat the other ones first. They say, we'll eat the other ones first. And the liberals say, whew, oh my gosh, like, you know, we saved ourselves. You know, we saved humanity. We'll continue humanity in a very nice way because we're nice people. In fact, the dinosaurs tell us we're nice. Of course, what they don't understand is dinosaurs save the nice people, their favorite people. They save them for dessert. They save them for dessert. Okay, this has to be something you must hear. This you must hear. This. Right, they save the best for last. They say, boy, that eating everybody else was great, but I still haven't, you know, my sweet tooth has not been, you know, sated yet. But oh, look at these lovely, sweet, nice liberals. Now it's time to have dessert. Yum, yum, yum. And so they've fallen for the exact same trap that everyone always falls for with the reptilians. And they're just laughing because they know the whole thing, and it's the women are who are really more into survival than the men. They feel the survival of the human race is their responsibility. They say, "Oh my gosh, we might be wiped out here. We can't have that." So they say, "Oh, I got to do something," and they say, "I don't think my warrior hero men can handle this. They'll get wiped out, and if we antagonize them, then they'll really wipe us out." But oh, I have an idea, you know, let's be nice to them, invite them in. Hey, we were waiting for you. Come on in. Let's have a party. I mean, we'd love to have you here. I mean, we love dinosaurs. We love reptilians. Yeah. So they think they're going to save humanity by being nice to the reptilians. This is the Adam and Eve thing. Okay, and it's been repeated throughout the cosmos, and it's been repeated here again. And the man says, "Wait a minute. I don't know if that'll work." She said, and she says, "Shut up, Adam. Shut up. Quiet. Don't say a word. I'm in charge here. Hi, reptilians. You know." Don't you think we're nice people? We love you, you know, and we can live in harmony, right? And the reptilians say, "Oh yeah, sure." And meanwhile, they're behind our backs, they're laughing. Say, "Oh my God, they're such idiots. They did the same thing again, thinking they're fooling us." You don't think they know that? Of course they know. It's the same old shtick all over again. And every time Adam says, "Hey, Eve, things aren't going very well. I mean, I think that they're taking over." Eve says, "Shut up. You don't know anything. Don't say a word. I got this. This is under my control. I got it. Don't worry. I can fool them. And meanwhile, the reptilians are just laughing all the way to the bank, you know. They know the whole game. So poor Adam's sitting here saying, "Man, I can't say a word. Every time I try to speak up, Eve, you know, just tries to crush me." And she's sure that she's got it all under control, but it sure doesn't look that way. Same old, same old, same old, same old here, okay? This is the same old stupid drama that's taken place so many times in the cosmos. Now, Adam, you know, Eve says Adam, you know, can't defeat the reptilians because her idea of Adam is he's a warrior hero to her and to humanity. And she doesn't really understand spirituality the way Adam does. Because Adam say, "Hey, you know, Eve, I've been studying a lot of, you know, the Dharma, and I believe there's a way that we can stop this from happening, really, with our minds." And Eve says, you know, "Duh, shut up, you that's too risky, you know. No, you're better as a warrior, you know, as warrior kings, but that won't work with the reptilians." And so then Adam says, but she says, shut up, this is too dangerous for that. We can't rely on something like that. That's too iffy, you know. So she doesn't really know what's possible. But some of the men are saying, "Hey, wait a minute, you know, we could stop them." And some of the women too trust it and say, "You know what, I think prayer can stop them." Okay, really religious women say, "You know, let's pray, and we can stop it through faith and prayer and right religious practices," which is true. That's how you stop the reptilians. But too many Eves have gotten involved in saying and panicked. They panicked, and they said, "No, we gotta invite them in. Let's play nice. Let's play nice. It's the only chance we have." And so men have been tuned out. I mean, basically the world is being run by Eve right now, thinking that she's running this plan, this scheme on the reptilians, that somehow it's going to work. And men have been tuned out. Their voices have been tuned out. Especially those who say, "Hey, no, we can stop them. Absolutely, we can stop them. It's a piece of cake." Call in the Dharma Kings. Call in the Dharma Kings if you want to stop them. We have the power to call in the Dharma Kings. Hello. Hello, you know? I mean, what in the world is Eve thinking? She's not thinking straight at all. Her thinking is coming from panic, from panic. She keeps thinking that she, you know, that she can rely on her, you know, cunning and feminine wiles to trick the reptilians. Meanwhile, they know that's exactly her game, and they're pretending like maybe they're being tricked, all the while to gain even more control over this world, to turn it into a plantation. To turn it into a plantation. Okay, that's their plan. We're the slaves, and the liberals hope that they're going to be the Uncle Toms of the plantation. That's a fact. They're thinking, my gosh, what if we do get enslaved? You know, they see and it was not going so well. You know, but then they say, well, wait a minute. You know, we don't want to be slaves. Let's learn how to control the slaves. We'll be the helpers of the, you know, overseers. We'll be the overseers, the Uncle Toms, who are make sure that the slaves stay nice slaves and don't get the reptilians, the owners of the plantation, angry at us. So they think that they're, you know, saving humanity by doing this. But meanwhile, those who are being enslaved saying, whoa, 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 wait a minute. You know, we don't want to be enslaved. And then the Eves say, shut up again, shut up, be quiet. You don't know what you're talking. They go to the reptilians, oh, they don't listen, they don't know what they're talking about. They're a bunch of idiots, you know. Or say, no. Let's call in the Dharma Kings. They'll liberate us from this. They'll liberate us. They said they would. Don't we have faith in them? Of course, we should have faith in them. They will liberate us. I made an open plea for help with the situation. You know who showed up the very next night in a dream? Longchenpa showed up. I didn't know who he was. He showed up ready to help. 100% ready, 100% committed. Now, I'll take Longchenpa any day against the reptilians, okay? Any day. Put your faith in the Dharma Kings, and the reptilians don't stand a chance. And they know that. They know that. That's why they approach Eve, because they know that if they panic Eve, she's going to say, wait a minute, I gotta rely on my feminine wiles, you know, to trick them. And she won't turn to the Dharma Kings for help. She'll rely on her own cleverness. This is what's happened with this world. This is what's happened. It's happened many, 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 many times in many places. Same old, same old, same old. What a joke, you know, the dream of existence is. What a joke. So, just a simple prayer for help, open-ended prayer, whoever can help, we need help. Longchenpa shows up with his apex array, you know. He doesn't come alone. I mean, he first came by himself, but what an array he has to protect us, right? And that's just one Dharma King. Okay. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. What is she going to do? That's quite a story, huh? We'll find out in hindsight, won't we? But it's going to be a lot. It is going to be a lot. And you think any reptilian can get over on her? There isn't a prayer of that happening. There's no chance of that happening. Zero. But Eve now, out of panic, has this complex that she's in charge and everything has to go through her because she's the negotiator with the reptilians. She's the one that they trust, you know, working out a deal with them. No, they're playing her for a fool, is what they're doing. They're playing her for a fool. So I'm not, you know, I'm speaking up. I'm speaking up. I'm not going to have my voice silenced by Eve just because she tells me shut up, because she's blowing it. You know, she's falling in the same trap that's been fallen into so many times before. So I'm not just going to, out of courtesy to her, be quiet. I don't want to embarrass her. No, are you kidding? I'm not going to be turned into a slave. I don't want any of us to be turned into slaves. Yeah, there's not a time for courtesy at this point. You know, she's you know, blowing it big time. And she needs to back off and realize, hey, this isn't working. What works? And get wise again and stop panicking. You know, there's too many women are in panic mode in the world right now, and it shows. It's very, very evident because they think humanity is going to be could very well be wiped out, and they think, you know, that they're the guardian of humanity, but it's all a dream, really, anyway. So there's no reason to panic about it. This is the situation in the world. It is so difficult for any man to say anything that's listened to by anyone. It's almost impossible, actually, unless he is, you know, basically toeing the line of what Eve wants him to say. So the reptilians will say, oh, yeah, Eve's got the slaves under control. That's great. Yeah, we can trust her. And she says, yeah. Just play like you're a good, docile slave, and they won't get mad. But the problem is, when you do that, you then become familiar with playing the role of a slave, and then the familiarity problem bites you. See, this is the trick the reptilians know and are using on us. And Eve isn't aware of this. She thinks, no, you play a slave for a while and we'll trick him and then at the right time we'll get free. No, it doesn't work that way. Because when you get used to pretending you're a slave, you believe you are a slave. And when you try to be liberated, suddenly terror grips you and you like immobilize and panic. Your mind panics and you can't do it. You can't do it. You can't do it. So this is the huge, huge danger with listening to Eve's little plan, her little scheme. It's a failed scheme. It's a scheme destined for failure. And you know, she what are you supposed to do? We're supposed to protect her, you know, feelings by not saying this, not shouting, "Hey, this won't work. This is a disaster." We're supposed to be just quiet. So she, why? There's no good reason at all. There's a courtesy. This is not a time for courtesy. It's not a time to harbor doubts about what's right, you know, or harbor some genteel attitude. You know, it's the difference between enslavement and no enslavement. So if they want to cry a river, that, you know, then they're going to have to cry a river about it. If their feelings get hurt, their feathers get ruffled, so be it. You know, in hindsight, they'll say, "Wow, you know, we panicked. That's a fact. When it comes to certain issues, like the survivability of their children, etc., women can panic. They can panic under certain pressures like the reptilians have put us under. Men, not so much. Not as much. We're really trained not to panic. Okay, to be a real man, you are trained. Under no circumstances do you panic, because we are put in dangerous circumstances throughout history. Being warriors, you cannot panic. That's the worst thing, okay? Because then you put everyone else's lives in jeopardy. Even if you lose a battle or are having trouble in a battle, you don't panic. You never panic, okay? You never panic. You never lose your head. You always stay calm, resolute, and confident. You always stay confident. And you have confidence in your brothers there, too. You have confidence in them. Just like a baseball manager comes out to take a pitcher out of the game who's getting maybe battered. They come out clapping their hands and they call someone from the bullpen. Now maybe this guy in the bullpen is kind of weak, you know, but the manager isn't going to let on to that. The manager would be clapping their hands and rubbing the baseball. I'm saying, "Man, here comes my ace in to close this, you know, to save us." And the good manager expresses confidence in their players at all times. Never does he get down and say, "Wow, we're getting crushed." Never. He always says, "We got this. We got this game. No doubt about it. My guys can get the job done. There's no doubt about it." So, we're trained. You always have faith and confidence in your capabilities. You never give up. You never panic, push the panic button. And you never get into these schemes, panic schemes, which bring upon the dreaded fault problem of familiarity upon us. You can't do that. You never play the loser. You should never play the loser. Okay, thinking that this is can trick somebody. No, you cannot do that. But this is what we've done. This is what the world has done. And it's a disaster. It is a disaster. So it's going to require upsetting the apple cart, maybe upsetting Eve's apple cart, you know? Absolutely. I think maybe some people weren't so happy I posted 300 pictures of Sri Sri Anandamayi. You know, they wanted one. And she said, "No, post all 300 right now." I said, but that's too many. She goes, "Dude, you want to do as I say or not?" Now, she is not Eve. I mean, she sees right through Eve. Yeah, she knows that Eve has panicked here. She knows that, of course. And so she says, "No." I said, but they're not going to like that. You know, and she says, "Hey, it's not a time for courtesies, like courtesy, you know. I mean, I did a little courtesy, but," she says, "hey, it's no time for courtesy. Clean it up, you know. You know, you're gonna do as I say or not." And I said, "Okay, you know, it's your, you're in charge. I know that you know what the winning strategy really is. So we'll do it your way. We'll do it your way. So really, that's what it's about right now. If it wasn't so bad, why would Longchenpa show up when I did this just total prayer from the heart? I said, we are in drastic trouble here in this world, and whoever can help us out, who truly can help us, I accept your help. I don't care who you are. I accept your help. He showed up that night, after the day after that prayer, that night. He showed up in my dream, gave me the vision of intrinsic spaciousness in the morning, and, you know, he said, I am here. I am here to help. Plain and simple. If it weren't so bad, why would he shown up immediately like that? Okay, it is really, really bad here. We have fallen for the reptilians' bluster. Once again, another world has fallen for their bluster. It's all bluster. Okay? It's all bluster. They think they're the king and queens, queens of doubt. And we think that, you know, we have that somehow our happiness depends on stabilizing doubt. And so we don't want them, we don't want to, you know, get them angry at us, and that will destabilize doubt. We think, no, eventually we'll be able to stabilize doubt and then we'll get free of them. No, as long as we're trying to stabilize doubt, they're going to rule over us, so to speak. Okay, that's a fact. The way to go about it is apex yoga, which is to let go of all doubt. Don't try to stabilize it. Don't try to stabilize it. Let go of the meditator and what is being meditated upon. The meditator is trying to stabilize doubt. Okay, realize that both of them are equally dissolved in intrinsic spaciousness. All right, you don't need a successful meditator. You need to be the non-meditating position of natural mind, the non-meditating abidance, abide in perfect non-meditation. That's the apex yoga way. That's Longchenpa's way. Okay, the supreme adept at apex yoga. Now, there are certainly others who have done this, many actually. He happens to be one who is regarded as a supreme adept at this, and is able to convey this to us in a very, very, very helpful way. Now, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, she's the absolute wild card. The reptilians have no idea. Nobody has any idea what she'll do, actually. They can't get a handle on her at all. At all. She has no story, no path. Absolutely, simply lives entirely in the now, with never a thought at all. Never a thought at all. So they can't read her thoughts because she doesn't have any. This is what the problem reptilians have with the Dharma Kings. The Dharma Kings don't have any thoughts. And the reptilians are expert at reading thoughts. They're very psychic. They can read thoughts. Which is why they're good at adept at controlling people. But the Dharma Kings don't have any thoughts. So it scares the heck out of the reptilians. Freaks them out completely. They think they're going into an abyss. They're losing their power, their control. Losing their dominion over doubt. Of course, doubt doesn't exist. So how can you have dominion over nothing? So, of course, they teach us thinking and thoughts. We cling to thoughts because it seems like then there's something to doubt. There's something to it because there's thoughts and concepts and struggle to it. But really, there's nothing at all there. So there's nothing to have dominion over, is there? So it's calling upon the Dharma Kings. In Christianity, of course, all Christians are taught to call upon Jesus Christ, the saints, the Holy Spirit, the angels, to protect them from the reptilians. The Luciferians, the Satans, the reptilians. This is the antagonist throughout history. Is we're warned that this reptilians are, you know, in the cosmos, and they love to eat planets up, you know, devour planets, and we need to protect ourselves from this. So we're taught how to protect ourselves. Religion tells us how to protect ourselves. And we call on Jesus. Christians call on Jesus and take protection in Jesus Christ, who again has no thoughts at all. Just love, just love, just love. The reptilians can understand personal love, thoughts of love, emotions, thoughts of love, but it cannot understand abstract love at all. They cannot read that at all. That's why they teach us reading and concepts and words and all this letter, you know, instead of abstract experiencing, because they can't read that. They can't control it. They don't know what to do about it. It's a void to them. It's like a void arises in their mind. It freaks them out, and they flee from it. They turn into trembling, you know, balls of jello. So they don't want us doing that. They want us, you know, caught up in words, caught up in words, caught up in concepts, caught up in scenarios, caught up in doubt, caught up in stories, caught up in time. And the Dharma kings tell us, no, you don't need any of that. Don't need any of that. Natural mind is free of doubt. Natural mind is certainty. You don't need any doubt. Doubt's just an attempt to try and be greater than God. That's all. So you don't need to battle, struggle with thought concepts at all. Just let them all go. Let the winning thoughts go. Let losing thoughts go. Let them all go equally. They're all just much ado about nothing. Much ado about doubt. So again, let the winning strategies go too, as far as doubt, as far as thinking goes, right? And just abide in no thought. The land of no thought. Land of certitude. What do we need to think about certitude? What thoughts do we need for certitude? We don't need thoughts for certitude. So, the world is in a fine mess right now, actually. Fine mess. That doesn't mean that we're going to capitulate, does it? It just means we need to call in some pretty good help here. That's what it means. It just means we need to up our game in terms of help. That's all it means. You know, there's no reason to panic. It's just, you know, when you're trained to not panic, then you can think very clearly. So I've trained myself to not panic. And so it seems like, you know, all is lost. But it's not. Not at all. All it means is that I have to up my game. That's how I look at it. Dissipated a sneeze there. Ah, you can dissipate a sneeze. You're not defeated. When the sneeze comes upon you like that, you're not defeated. You can dissipate it. So you have to call upon a higher game. You got to up your game when things seem to be going really bad, which they are in the world and have been for quite some time. Just you up your game. Say, okay, so this is what I do. I say, okay, wow. That's terrible. So, what do I need to do? What do I need to do? How do I up my game? Because it's not good enough, right, the way it is now. So, it has to get better. We have to turn this around. How do we turn it around? And you're just calm. You're not thinking a bunch of thoughts, not panicking. And you have faith. You have faith. I have faith in Dharma Kings. I know they will do it. I know there's a way to do it. So, why should I panic? I just need to be calm and listen quietly to their advice. So, there's a way. There are ways. They never run out of ways to do it. Okay? We just need to tune into it and realize the strategy never works, okay? It never works. And so we have to abandon the Eve strategy. We're not abandoning Eve, but we are abandoning her panic strategy, okay? And that's just how it is. Just how it is. It's not humanity that needs to be saved. It's us that need to be saved from both humanity and the reptilians, actually. Really. Because we're not bodies at all. We're spirit. We're just dreaming of bodies to try to cast doubt on what we are. But we don't have to get rid of humanity either. We just have to realize there's really no such thing in the first place. Never has been. And this is something, you know, that Eve wanting to be the, you know, heroine of doubt, thinking that, you know, she can create a new creation. Maybe she doesn't want to hear that. You know, no, the body, you know, she wants it to be body-based. No, there's no such thing as body-based. The body doesn't do anything, actually. It's just an inert, neutralness, actually. Just inert neutralness, like a puppet. It's all the mind. It's all the mind. It always has been the mind and nothing but the mind. So nobody can give birth to a new creation. It's not possible like that. It's just everything is the mind. Everything we're experiencing is just the mind imagining that we're experiencing it. Totally, totally, without any exception at all. So what Eve could do is realize that, like, hey, I never was really Eve. I never was Eve. That was just a dream. Eve is a dream of spirit that I'm having. The meditator is a dream we're having. It's not the meditator that's having the dream. It's spirit that's having the dream. Spirit dreams of a meditator or Eve, Adam and Eve, and a dream and dreams that Adam and Eve are dreaming the dream, but they're not. They're not doing anything, actually. It's spirit that's dreaming at all. Simultaneously, equally. There's no levels or layers to the dream at all. There's not like sub-dreamers, you know, at all. There aren't any. It's not like Adam and Eve are the dreamers, and then there's sub-dreamers, and sub-sub-sub-dreamers. None of that is true. None of that is true. So all comes from spirit. It all comes from mind simultaneously, with no layers or levels to it at all. That's why we can talk about, you know, bring up spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness, where obviously there's no layers or levels at all to that. And then we think, well, what happened to our layers and levels? They've never been there. They've never been there at all. We've just been dreaming of them, but there's only one dreamer of the dream. There's not many dreamers, really, just one. It's just the mind that's dreaming. There's not some sub-mind dreaming anything at all. Never has been, never will be. So this is apex yoga, what we're doing right here. And I know some of you get it, you know? Some of you really do get it. But there's this pressure of sparing Eve's feelings, but there is no Eve, actually. That's just part of the dream that spirit is dreaming. And spirit really doesn't want to spare its own feelings. It's repentant. It says, you know what? I can't keep hiding behind underneath the skirt of Eve, trying to protect myself, saying, oh no, it'll hurt her Eve's feelings. You know, that's just a ploy I'm using it to avoid, you know, repentance and realizing, wow, I try to be greater than God. You know, what a foolish gambit, right? So one spirit, you know, can accept this and stops trying to kill itself, you know, to do all this foolishness that it's doing. And really it says, wow, God's not angry with me. This was just my own silly, you know, absurdity that I tried to do. Then it can accept this. It can accept this. And it doesn't, it realizes, there's no feelings to spare anywhere, really. The repentant mind realizes there's no feelings to spare. They're not walking on eggshells, you know, trying to protect some sensibilities or something. Not at all. And it used to be in religious societies that, you know, both women and men can speak up and not spare the feelings of Adam and Eve at all, and repent, and it's not a problem. But in the modern world, the reptilians have had so much success. We're so scared. The Eve strategy says, don't, you know, you've got to show that that she's. She's, you know, really good, and we really honor her and respect her, and there's no trickery going on, and you can't say anything. You're supposed to be quiet. Supposed to be quiet to try and, you know, trick the reptilians. Forget it. They're not tricked. Okay? We have to realize that they are not tricked. You don't trick the reptilians. You just simply realize they have no power. As long as you're trying to trick them, you're being tricked, thinking they have power. You're thinking that doubt has some power, and it doesn't have any power. So, forget about trickery. That doesn't work. That's the wrong path to take. It's the wrong path. You just face it directly, and you just call upon the Dharma Kings and say, Dharma Kings, it's your play here. It's your play. We'll do what you say. And they tell us, hey, apex yoga is where it's at. Apex yoga. And you start paying attention to that. Longchenpa's apex yoga. And you realize, oh my gosh, they don't have any power at all. What kind of power can a dream have? It's only when we try to see the dream as fragments that we get deceived. How can a dream have fragments? Isn't it all one dream? How can there be fragments of a dream? That's ridiculous, isn't it? That's totally insane. Fragments of a dream? The dream is just one dream, one whole. It's a dream. There's not a sub-dream to a dream. It's all just a dream. It's all make-believe. How could there be layers and levels and fragments of make-believe that are somehow different than some other fragment of make-believe? Make-believe is all just the same, make-believe. And that's apex yoga. That's just apex yoga. It's very simple. So don't get distracted from apex yoga. As Longchenpa says, when I get distracted, I lose sight of the path to freedom, which is solely responsible for prolonging my samsaric suffering. That is the distraction, right? Now that I've seen the plague of conceptual thinking, I'm off to live in the unborn peace of the wild woods, the unborn peace. The busy cities are bonfires of desire. I see now that if I catch the terrible plague of existence, I'll just keep wandering in the canyons of samsara. So I'm off right now to the wild woods. It's that simple. Right? Yeah. And you know, the way the world's going is just like we're just like we say, hey, we're being enslaved. We have to up our game. So Longchenpa says, since I'm brokenhearted here in the city of existence, my mind sends these tidings its own way. A story about resorting to the peaceful forest for someone who apply their heart to the Dharma path. The peaceful forest is really apex yoga. Apex yoga. Apex yoga. Where we see a dream is all one and the same. There aren't fragments of a dream that we need to contrast and compare with one another at all. All doubt is equally baseless. It's only when we start comparing, thinking there's different types of doubt, intensities of doubt, all that stuff, that's where we fall into the ocean of samsaric suffering. Every being in existence is threatened by affliction and totally bound by terrifying chains of duality. Because each one of us has at some point or another been my mother or father. To free them, I must go to the wildwoods. I must go to the wildwoods to free them. I must go. Wildwoods is a metaphor. How do I go to the wildwoods? Practice apex yoga. Say, I am an apex yogin or yogini. I am an apex yogin. I am an apex yogini. Claim it for yourself. In other words, you're taking refuge in the Dharma kings and their practice. Apex yoga is their practice. All these outer things we keep looking to are impermanent and completely unreliable. Seeing how they change like autumn clouds, my heart knows I must go to the peaceful wildwoods. The sun of the good times of yore has set, and the moon of mean people is on the rise. The darkness of evil-doing Madras closes in on all sides, or Maras, evil-doing Maras closes in on all sides. I see it, so I must go to the wildwoods right now. I see it. Eve's strategy isn't working. Believing that the reptilians have power, that doesn't work. You have to see that a dream doesn't have any power. They're not different powers in a dream. The only power in the dream comes from the dreamer of the dream. And there's one dreamer, and the dreamer, that one dreamer is dreaming all of the dream. There's nothing in a dream that's dreaming itself. So the dream isn't having a dream. There's nothing in the dream that has any power at all. And this has to be seen. So we cannot play these clever games of trickery. We cannot play these games. That's ruination. That's the catastrophe. And of course, Eve is not without an eye towards all the glittering commodities that the reptilians bring. I mean, we all have a little bit of interest, don't we? And of course, Eve is keen upon how can I advance my children, you know, and grandchildren. How can I advance them? Just look at all this technology the reptilians are bringing. Look at all this stuff. Huh. Yeah, like, how can I get my hands on this without, you know, at least my children not falling prey to, you know, enslavement here and becoming cows of, you know, fear cows for the reptilians. So the situation is not without materialistic lust, right? Absolutely, that plays a role. That's why we're taught, religion teaches us to be very humble, very thrifty, very humble, waste not, want not, do not be chasing after worldly riches. Do not be chasing after them. Because then you're going to resort to trickery to try to get more, you see. Thinking that some part of a dream has more value than some other part of the dream is delusion. So we should live a humble life. And so when the reptilians come dangling all their fancy beads, you know, we just say, you know, we're not interested in your beads. You know, we choose to live a simple, humble life. Not all glamorous and glittery. You know, so we're not interested in your stuff. Take a hike. What can they do? Okay, nothing they can do then. Not interested in your empowerments, you know, that you say you have for us, all these empowerments. Not interested. Empowerments, what's that? What do you mean? How do you empower aspects of a dream? That's ridiculous. That's not apex yoga at all. Apex yoga is the yoga of the Dharma kings. It's the yoga of Rama Maharshi. He says meditation on something is, you know, trying to stabilize it. That's not the answer. It's letting go of that meditation that's the answer. Atma Vichara. It's that's a stat that gives you the silence, the great silence of abidance as the self. So the fault is trying to pretending to be a meditator on something, to attain something through meditation, to reach some attainment through it. Give up all attempts at meditational attainment and apply non-meditation to the mind. That's apex yoga. That's what we do here. That's what we do, and it's working. This is what will turn the tide against those hungry dinosaurs. Yeah. They're hungry for their ego trip, their ego food, you know, right? Hungry for us to believe in their power, the power of doubt, to validate their imaginary role of lords of doubt. The dragons of doubt, you know. It's all just a silly dream of continuity fear. So it's time for Eve to, you know, shut up and get busy promoting and helping apex yoga. That you can do a lot, absolutely. But in terms of you know, being the one doing all the talking, that, you know, that time's over with. It's over with. It's way over with. It's time for apex yoga, apex yogins to speak up in the world now. And speak up about the Dharma King's way, the way of the Dharma Kings, the apex yoga way. So Eve can redeem herself, not that she needs to redeem because there really is no Eve or Adam, but the spirit could feel like it's sort of redemptive if Eve can say, you know what, wow, let's get busy now and let's do it this way. And so let us be effectively helpful with that, which certainly they certainly can. Eve certainly can do that. Absolutely. In the social sphere, Eve can do a tremendous help. She just has to stop running this little, you know, trickery game on the reptilians. That is the disaster. That is what the reptilians expected her to do. They came here with a lot of confidence that they could get Eve to panic and have her run her little game, and then they know exactly how to play that and win win at that. But if Eve stops playing that game, the reptilians are going to say, what the heck's going on? It's going to throw them for a loop, you know? It's going to flip them out. I say, what the heck is Eve doing? She's suddenly become humble and repentant, and she's not playing that game anymore. She's turning the Dharma Kings. Like, they're going to say, uh-oh. You know, we don't know what to do. We don't know what to do. So the women are still very feisty of the world, very feisty, very puffed up, feisty, you know. We're in charge, large and in charge. Yeah, that has to, definitely, Eve has to say, hey, wait a minute. This isn't working, and let's go into this humble mode. Let's go into this humble mode. Repentant, truly repentant, though, it's true repentance, and just no strategy. You know, I don't need one. Apex yoga, no strategy, non-meditation, and faith in the Dharma Kings, and faith in love, and faith in super positivity, true super positivity. Faith in the sublime grace of God, and just let that flow. Just let it flow. Just help it flow. Just help it flow. Just let it flow. And be moved by that, you know? Eve allows herself to be truly moved by it, not as a strategy, but just as love, you know? Not as a strategy. And gratitude, like, wow, this works. We are being, the grace of God is saving us from horrible samsaric enslavement. And so, it's not me that's saving, it's the grace of God that's saving us. Okay? It's not Eve that's saving us, it's the grace of God that's saving us. And so Spirit has to, you know, ultimately abandon this Eve-Adam nonsense. A genuine yogin, apex yogin, or yogini can speak up if it's genuine. There's not many that are apex yogins or yoginis, actually. Not at all in the world right now. But you never know where they might pop up. Right? Now, Eve is very clever. She's very clever, and she keeps running her tricky strategies under a covering of spirituality. She's very, very clever at that. But it's very transparent. You know, I mean, you can just see it. It's obvious. But, I mean, she thinks she's being very clever. But it's very obvious, actually. It's super difficult for the Eve complex to be straight. Super difficult, because she says, I've got to do something for my children, and I can't trust the Dharma Kings entirely. It's too risky. So she tries to play both ways. This is what happens. For B, I'm not enthralled by children or humanity or any of that stuff. So I don't panic, and I don't think in that way at all. I don't think like, whoa, I gotta save the children. I don't think that way. I say we gotta save us all, Spirit, from its own delusion. There aren't any really children or mothers or people or anything. It's Spirit dreaming that there is, really, is the problem, and familiarity problem. So it's a spiritual problem we have. We need to be able to gently, you know, lose interest in dreaming is what we need to do. So that's the real goal. So that's how I see it. I never see it through the lens of humanity. I never see it that way. Because, you know, we can dream of endless entityness, time, space, process, formness, diversity, biological diversity. We can dream that in innumerable ways. It's not just humanity. You know, if it's not humanity, we dream some other entity, and we're dreaming many, 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 many different types of entities all over. So that's not the point. Humanity isn't the point. Offspring isn't the point. Offspring is just is the play of doubt, actually. It's just the play of doubt. So it's really Spirit that needs to be saved from its own arrogance, and right now from its severe bias against certainty. Severe bias. That's what needs to be saved. And we can all together work on that. We can work on that. And it'll help the reptilians too, as they realize, wow, we can't really enslave them. Wow, what happened? Maybe we're not the omnipotent lords of doubt. Huh. Maybe we have a bias, some kind of bias is the problem. But maybe we're biased against certainty in some way. Yeah, so they'll become reflective too. They'll start reflecting on their inability to enslave us. And so it's a win-win-win-win-win all the way around. And men really have to stop catering, you know, doing all these courtesies to Eve. You know, it's over with. They got to realize that they're the ones who are going to be enslaved. And so they got to say, no. That doesn't work for me. I'm calling on the Dharma Kings. And, you know, Eve gets upset. Well, yeah. Maybe she will for a while. But maybe after a while she realizes you're serious. And say, huh. Start thinking, I don't know. Maybe there is a way. Right? But you got to stand up. You can't just, you know, crumple. You know, when Eve says, shut up. You can't just crumple. Because she's most certainly going to say, shut up. My whole life I've had Eve telling me to shut up. And look what's happened to the world. Look what's happened to the world. It's exactly what I said would happen. Basically, the world has just collapsed into, you know, serfdom. Reptilian serfdom is what's happened. And anyone that speaks up, they say, shh, we're good little slaves. We're good little serfs. We don't talk to the lords of doubt that way. Nobody talks to them that way. Well, talking to dream figures, we got to be careful in talking to dream figures. Spirit has to be careful about the dream figures that it's dreaming, how it talks to them. Well, what is that? What? Spirit needs to be careful about how it talks to the dream figures that it's dreaming? Why? Why? They're just dream figures, imaginary make-believe figures. They don't have any power over spirit at all. They can't do anything. They're just ornamentation of, they're just intrinsic spaciousness, an ornamentation of it. There's nothing there at all as some separate self. Spirit doesn't need to be careful in that way. Now, spirit needs to be pragmatic in its own bias, you know, evaporating its own bias. But that's a different story. That's the grace of God as we do right spiritual practice. That's the Dharma. Okay, so everyone needs to become dharmic now, okay? Enough of Adam and Eve. It's time to become dharmic. And it's difficult for women in the world because they're so used now to being the leaders in this game with the reptilians that they don't know how to give it up. The familiarity is you say, well, I have to keep playing some game. I have to keep doing it. They have to take a step back. They have to take a step back now. They'll catch up. But the first they have to take a step back and stop. Let this habit die down. Let this habit die down. It has to happen. It's a bad habit. So you can't, you have to let the familiarity with bad habits die down. You can't just decide, okay, that's a bad habit. Okay, I get it. And now I'm back, you know. Now, it doesn't work that way. It never works that way. So you have to be wise and say, wow, that's like an extremely bad habit. So I just got to be quiet for a while. And get used to not saying anything, really. I can do a lot, but just be in the background for a while. Just be in the background for a while. Until you settle down and start getting into apex yoga. Say, wait a minute. It's all a dream is just the same. It's all the same. And you actually then start to become very dharmic. So you have to make a transition into being very dharmic. And it's not just an intellectual, oh, okay, I get it. Sort of thing. What do you mean? I'm super biased against certainty. So that means you're super biased against certainty. You get it? Okay, now you're going to have to gradually evaporate that bias. It means there's a lot of work involved. You don't just say, I get it, and that means it's gone. How does familiarity bias disappear when you just say you get that you have familiarity bias? It doesn't work that way. That's magical belief, to think it works that way. It's a magical belief. And this is where most are stuck. Most spiritual aspirants are stuck because they don't understand the familiarity problem. They just don't understand it. They think that by seeing it, it's not there anymore. No, it's a familiarity problem. It's formless. It doesn't vanish because we see the dynamic. The dynamic is still there. So you have to gradually evaporate this bias, a severe bias and continuity fear that's telling us that reality is a void, an abyss. So it never happens just by seeing it. So some have claimed that it does, you know, but they always crash and burn later on. They always do. They think they have it, but it still has them, actually. When they think they have it, it has them. Because in their arrogance, they say, no, I'm so smart, I should be able to, my smartness should just see it and say, okay, that's it. That's called arrogance. If that was the case, I would have been a spiritual teacher, you know, 60 years ago. From the day I was born, if it was that easy, I was plenty smart enough to see it. But that didn't cure the problem at all. But too many have thought, oh, I see it, and I'm such a smart, A-plus student. that I'm, well, I'm what they say is, well, I'm smarter than others, therefore it shouldn't be a problem for me. This is the big mistake that has been made throughout history, but so many have made that mistake. We probably all made that mistake. Just because we reach a point where we're smarter than others, we use that relativity, that contrast, of thinking, well, if I'm smarter than others, then it shouldn't be a problem for me. I can't admit it's a problem, because then I can't play the game, play the role of being smarter than others. Because others will look at me and say, oh, you're struggling so bad with this, so you're not that much smarter than us, you know? So that's called an ego trip. To say that you're smarter than others, therefore the familiarity problem shouldn't be a problem for you, is the ego trip that we get trapped in. And many, many have gotten trapped in this, and they become big shot gurus, only to crash and burn later on and lead people back into, you know, very bad misery and suffering. It's happened over and over and over and over again. Because, you know, they got bit by it. Their arrogance, they got bit by it, thinking that contrast has some sort of relevance to the situation. It doesn't. That's like saying, you know, you have 10 cents and someone else has 5 cents, and you're like, you say, oh man, I'm super rich. Let me go on a spending spree, man. I'm going to buy up the world. No, you've got 10 cents. You got your 10 cents worth. Just because someone else has only 5 cents worth, that doesn't mean you're rich. This is the problem that has struck so many here. And you get these gurus that crash and burn. They're not real gurus. They're arrogant. You know, they're arrogant, smart asses, really. But they just, seeing that they're smarter than others, they think that means that they've got it. There's nothing to get. You have to evaporate the continuity fear and lose interest in doubt. You have to lose interest in it. Getting it isn't the answer. Losing interest in it is the answer. And as long as you think you're smarter than others and that's your trip, then you're not losing interest in doubt, because you're only in doubt can there seem to be a difference, you know, between us. And that's the reptilian trip. You know, so you're really being like a reptilian when you're that way. They're reptilian gurus. I think they're gurus. Yeah, the reptilians think they're gurus, because they play this game, you know, of thinking they're smarter. Therefore, they shouldn't have a problem. They don't have a problem. They have a severe problem. Bias against certainty. We all do. We all do. That's why Christianity calls everyone to get down on their knees together and pray together. There's no one higher and mightier than somebody else in genuine religion. Is everybody gets down on their knees and prostrates to God and says, God, we have a very severe problem. I have a severe problem. I'm a sinner. I have severe bias against certainty. That's what being a sinner means. I am a sinner before you. I bow before you as a sinner and ask for your grace to set me free from this awful affliction I have. We all do it together. Okay? This is very important. We've got all these smart asses, you know, ruling the world for a long time now, right? One after the other after the other. You see them down on their knees, you know, give a presidential address. Just before giving the address, do you see them get on their knees and say, God, on behalf of everyone in the country, I come before you as a severe sinner, knowing that I have a severe bias against the certainty of reality. And I'm asking for you to shed your grace upon me as a sinner and to shed the grace upon everyone in this country as sinners. And we put our faith in your grace to help our country out. Who do you see doing that? Who do you see doing that? Really doing it. I mean, in India, they go through the song and dance better than most places, right? But it's still, you know, somewhat of a song and dance. It's a big production and stuff, but it's not really calling yourself a sinner, you know. It could be a lot better, let's put it that way. They go through the motions. At least they go through the motions. But it needs to be much, much more real. You know, it needs to be much more real. The Tibetans, you know, try to keep it real. Right? They try to keep it real. They try. They got to do better too. We all have to do better. I mean, who among us claims we don't have to do better? I'd like to know who that is. Who among us claims that we don't have to do a lot better? Shouldn't be a single one of us here on this planet. There shouldn't be a single one of us on this planet that says, you know, we got it. We don't have to do better. No, we should all say we need to be on our knees before God and say, God, help us, because we need to up our game to a huge extent. We're really, really failing badly. Our bias is really biting us severely. So we need all the help you have. Every bit of it. Every bit of it. And we accept every bit of it. This should be the attitude of everyone on the planet. Everyone. You know what? The reptilians would be to make a hasty retreat out of here. They would absolutely turn tail and get the heck out of Dodge. It would be completely repulsive to them. They'd say, this planet, horrible place, terrible place. They'll go back to the other place and say, you know what? What a garbage dump, that planet. We don't want that planet at all. It's horrible. The people there are completely insane. Completely insane. We don't even want anything to do with them. Let's quarantine the place, man. We're never going back to that place. That's what would happen, actually. And we can make it happen. We can make it happen. We can make it happen. I got down on my knees today. I said, God, I need your help. I need your help. I really need your help. How many people get down on their knees every day and say, God, I'm a terrible sinner, and I really need your help. I know it's very fashionable. The reptilians have made it very fashionable to try to highlight the notions that nobody's a sinner here, you know. They made it fashionable. That is the wrong approach. It is very much the wrong approach. There isn't such a thing as sin. In other words, we aren't tainted by the dream. Jesus points it out in A Course in Miracles. But we are most certainly extremely biased against certainty. And that's what sin means. So let's not give a wrong definition of sin and then claim that we're not sinners. That's a silly little game, isn't it? Now, the right definition of sin is we have a severe bias against certainty. And we, therefore, keep jumping into the arms of doubt over and over and over again and trying to appease doubt. And the reptilians come along and say, we know how to stabilize doubt. We are the stability of doubt. We can make everything stable. Stable kingdom of doubt. And we say, oh gosh, maybe that's what we need, you know. Yeah. Fall for that trap over and over and over and over. So, California. Beautiful day today. Supposed to rain in the weekend. That's okay. Four beautiful days, 4 days of rain. We'll take that right now. Eventually, it will smooth out and glorious days will be the rule. So, we'll wind this one down. It's been very intense. Very, very intense. Very much from the heart. Very much dharmic. You know, this is dharmic. This talk is dharmic. It's apex yoga dharma. Apex yoga and dharma is what this is. What you're hearing is apex yoga and dharma. And the more you hear it, the better off you're going to be. That is it. Okay, the more you hear it, the better off you're going to be. And again, you at some point you can realize, you know what? This is something I have to do. I have to do it. It's time to get down to business right now. All right, no more time to waste. No more courtesy calls. I'm not making any more courtesy calls. No time for courtesy calls. There is no time for courtesy calls right now. And I'm trying to live that way. I made a mistake yesterday, but it's tough. And maybe it was helpful thing, but really, don't make courtesy calls. Only do what you call the apex yogin dharma within you, being very apex yogin dharmic within you. That inner intuition. Only do what that tells you to do. Okay, don't make some courtesy call. because you're feeling like maybe some. I don't want to feel guilty. Their feelings, blah blah. Their feelings. Oh, their feelings are being controlled by the reptilians. You know, come on. So, don't make courtesy calls anymore. Just do what your intuition tells you to do. That's it. And if some people don't like it, well, there's no time to harbor guilt or doubts at all about what you're doing. If you go with your intuition, there's no reason to harbor any doubts at all. Don't harbor any doubts, because it will turn out to be the right play to make. I don't care how many crocodile tears are cried, okay? It'll turn out to be the right play. So just make the play and enjoy the intensity of it. And you might feel tired, because it's like, whoa, wow, you know? I'm following my intuition now. And I'm not listening to everyone's telling me to shut up, or whatever. I'm just following my intuition. Not a time to harbor doubt. Not a time for courtesy at this point. Okay, not a time for courtesy. When the battle is full on, you know, there's no time for courtesy at this point. There's a time for courtesy, there's a time for no courtesy. And this time right now, no time for courtesy right now. If someone posts, like, on Facebook, anything political or anything that has to do with animals, boom, you know, I'm not getting notifications from them anymore. You know, some dog stuff. I mean, people are just like, you know, the whole dog thing. I'll get into that in another video. I understand what that's about now. It was revealed to me today. That's a whole other thing. But, no, I mean, no notifications. No notifications. You know, if they can't handle their stuff, you know, wait until they can. Got no more time for courtesy, all right? The people are so caught up in thinking they need to post politically. That's not dharmic. Politics is not dharmic. Social activism is not dharmic. It's not. Animals are not dharmic, okay? They're not dharmic. That's, you know, err on the side of caution, okay? Err on the side of caution. There is a way, but you have to understand, the animals don't want you turning to them, using them as an excuse for your own projected sensitivities. Oh, don't hurt my feet. You're hurting my dog's feeling, you know. You can't do that. You can't say that. My dog doesn't like it. This makes me upset. When I get upset, my dog gets upset. They'll say, well, I don't mind being upset, but my dog really gets upset when I get upset. And, you know, that's cruelty to animals. That's their whole shtick. You know, that's the trick that they're using now. That's their trick, okay? Cruelty to animals. And they project all their feelings onto the animal, or they say that their dog experiences everything I experience. So if you hurt my feelings, my dog's feelings are hurt too. And that's cruelty to animals. You're causing unnecessary, needless suffering to an animal, a dog. That's their clever little ploy the reptilians have trained them in. Now the dogs are saying, what the heck are you talking about? You know, I can handle it, you know. I love dogs, I love cats, I love animals, and they love me. They help me out a lot. And, but they say, hey, you know, don't listen to my master. They're crazy. You keep doing what you're doing, you know, because liberate us from these crazy humans. You know, the dogs say, my God, they're using us as a scape, like, you know, using us to try to protect their own insanity. That's not helpful at all. How can we help these crazy humans? That's what the animals are thinking. How can we help these crazy humans? They're trying to use us to protect their own, you know, bias against certainty. He says, we don't want to help out in that way. Man, what can we do? What can we do? Help us! Apex Yogans, help us! Liberate us from the humans! Crazy, what do you mean cruelty? What are we, fragile or something, you know? Teaching us to be fragile? You gotta bring the dogs everywhere. Oh, the dog will be fragile if, you know. Come on. Dog looks at you and says, what a bunch of wimps. What a bunch of wimps. Wow. Feel sorry. They feel sorry for us, you know. That's the truth. I mean, animals do all sorts of stuff to help me. If I ask them, they will. They absolutely will. Then they do all the time. I should ask them more often. I ask the birds a lot, and birds are fabulous, aren't they? They're absolutely fabulous. I love birds. It's hard for us to project our feelings onto birds, isn't it? Because the birds, they're just fly off. Say, what do you mean I'm fragile? I go anywhere I want to go, anytime I want to go. You don't have any control over me. So I love birds. I love their freedom. They're awesome, aren't they? I just say to birds, you know, show us your freedom. You know, show us your freedom, man. Show us what it's like. You're not fragile, are you? Birds aren't fragile. They're tough, aren't they? They're really tough cookies. They're awesome. Man, they need to fly a couple thousand miles. Boom. Here we go. And birds, they're just amazing. You don't see birds crying, do you? Unless you got them in a cage. That's it for this one.